Welcome back home, I'm going to say.
It's nice to hear that. You know, always whenever I've run into someone, whether it's Dumasani, whether it's Barbara Masekela, and I said, when are you going home?
No, this is your home. This is literally your second home.
Yes, absolutely.
Because I feel like I know you so well already, and I'll tell you why. You share a birthday with my husband, the 22nd of July.
Oh, yeah?
Uh-huh. Oh. Some way to rock and roll.
It's so fascinating. I'm always fascinated with the history. When I say my second home, you know, for more than well over 100 years, the AME Church has been a very, very strong, has very strong presence in South Africa, and certainly a part of the migration of gospel music came through the relationship that I had to the church. In fact, I'm always, because I grew up CME, Christian Methodist Episcopal, but my grandmother and my aunt were all AME, so I come out of the AME tradition. And as you know, the AME they were always doing something. They were the abolitionists.
That's right.
When they formed more than 200 years ago, and they have a long tradition of fighting and struggling for human rights all over the world, wherever black people live.
But you've been an activist all your life. South Africa has been one of the struggles in forefront that you have taken on. I think of the plays that you acted in, Afrofeedback shows.
Yeah.
Sizwe Banzi's Dead, Usman and Yena, Master Harold and the Boy.
Yes.
What was the other one? The Blood Knot, is that
the
it?
The Blood Knot, The Island.
That's right.
Yeah. Lesson from Aloes,
Those plays, what significance do they have in your life?
Well, their significance was that they drew me closer to the struggle around the anti-apartheid struggle. On the one hand, politically, but I didn't need to be drawn closer to that because I was involved in the anti-apartheid struggle as early as 1973, as when I was a student. But beyond that, when I was involved in the African Liberation Support Committee, but what the plays provided me with was a vehicle to not only learn the craft of acting because of this very wonderful, beautiful language and writing that is part of that has given to us, who God has given to us, but also to say whose side am I on in the world. And I think what's important as an artist, and what all artists say, whether they do it whether they make a verbal statement or whether they do it subconsciously, what they do is decide what's important to them in the world and whose side they are on in the world. And I hope that my work reflects that, whose side am I on in the world.
And your relationship with Mr. Mandela?
Well, he often calls me his son. But I'm sure
I'm one of many
sons that he has. There are many sons that he has in the world. I'm sure that would be honored to say that be referred to as a son.
You know, I believe in living in astrology. You both are Cancerians, so maybe that you are his son.
Well, you know, it's interesting. When I worked on the screenplay, this was 1986,
yeah,
when I worked on Mandela. I often, when I reading him and reading, say, Winnie's letters, and all the kind of reading his letters and everything else, I really kind of tried to imagine my own reaction, or I begin to associate my own reaction or what I felt writing in those very intimate moments with his, you know. So I made the connection, and maybe because of the fact that we're Cancerian, you know, and our birthdays are just 4 days apart.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah.
But tell me, one thing I noticed is that even in movies that were unrelated to South Africa, you always somehow brought some type of a connection, Lethal Weapon 1, in fact, and 2, there was a sticker on the refrigerator. Yeah. Why?
Well, I think on the one hand, there's a way in which movies have like this subtle way of informing people, a very suggestive way, and we said they're suggestive in so many ways. They're suggestive in terms of the products that are around, what you drink, what is smoked, what is on the table, the types of place, the type of living room. Movies acculturate people in that way. In fact, the whole idea of a refrigerator, now everyone has something, usually, in a very active household that has children and a lot of people very involved in the household, they have little stickers on the refrigerator.
Talking about Hollywood's influence.
Yeah.
Your views about Hollywood now?
So Hollywood is not a vehicle in which it has the capacity to allow us to be better human beings. It's not part of the scenario, you know. Of course, they're aberrations. They're things that slip through under the table, under the rug. They're movies that are very extraordinary, and you find out, wow, I learned something about the human dynamic in those movies. But that's not the course where Hollywood takes. It does not put us in a situation where we are challenged, in such a way that we understand our fears. We're challenged in such a way that we're able to reach out and have a compassion, real true compassion, not the symbolic kind of compassion, but real true compassion and understanding of our people. There has to be a way in which we can use the vehicles that we have of communication. It doesn't happen on Fox News. It doesn't happen on CNN because there are other objectives there. We have to understand it. We have to create another kind of truth, that one that really heightens our understanding of what really are the present dangers that are confronting us. And they don't all begin with the T, you know. There are present dangers that are confronting us as a world, as a human species, you know, and those are things that we have to say. The present dangers that are confronting us when we find that most of the world lives in abject poverty. Mm-hmm. The present dangers that are confronting us when we see that a great deal of the world is incapable of producing its own food.
But icons like yourself, like Morgan Freeman, Denzel Washington, Halle Berry, and others, are you, though, able to use from movies to change the perceptions in many ways?
I don't want to hold us accountable to that, to always being able to make movies in terms of that are informative, because I think that's romantic and probably unrealistic. The question becomes, is what else do we do as citizens? Mm-hmm. What else, how do we use our base and our popularity as citizens, you know, which we are, to inform people, to address issues, to talk about issues. Now, that also has personal ramifications to it. That also has an idea. I mean, some people maybe not are comfortable in front of a crowd. Maybe some people are not don't feel that they have anything to say. But I think on the one hand, it is when we do and feel that urgency to do something, then we're compelled or should do that. I mean, Harry Belafonte played a very enormous role in a lot of ways in setting in motion. So probably the role that he played short-circuited his career. He played a major role in the civil rights movement. Harry Belafonte was the person who put up the money for the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. Now, what would have happened without the Student Nonviolent Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC, perhaps we would not have had Freedom Summer. Perhaps we would not have had the massive emphasis on voter registration.
Malcolm X is another one.
Malcolm X.
So he said, I want to look at the world through the eyes of Martin Luther King or Fannie Mae. Fannie Lou Hamer, rather.
Yeah.
The eyes of Malcolm X and Paul Robertson.
Yeah.
Just tell us why.
Because one, their perspective was international.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can talk about either one of those. I mean, I you could describe it. Fannie Lou Hamer was a part of SNCC, was a sharecropper, had also gone to Guinea, Conakry, had been time there, and had a much wider range of understanding the struggle of all human beings and the relationship that struggle had to the struggle of African Americans. I think that's critical. What's critical is understanding the relationship that the struggle of the entire planet, whether they're South Africans, whether they're Guatemalans, whether they're South Asians, wherever, whatever the relationship that is, their struggle is related to our struggle. And I think they were able to articulate that, understand that, and articulate that. The problem that we have now is that we often, in the civil rights movement, is left exclusively to the idea that it was only African Americans, and not understanding that the struggle of the civil rights movement was a struggle in part that included the struggle for national identity for people around the world.
So this boy from the projects of San Francisco ends up in Hollywood becoming an award-winning actor. Is that what you plan to be in life?
No. I majored in economics.
Mm-hmm.
I was very much influenced when I was in my early 20s, 20, 21 years old, by the writings of Julius Nyerere. I thought that I would want to go to Tanzania and be a part of that when I was very young, 21, 22 years old. It was perhaps the beginning of my let's use the word Africanization.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah, when I began to read the writings when I first read Mandela when I was 20 years old in the late 60s. I first read his first book, first writings, collection of his speeches, No Easy Walk to Freedom, which was published in about 1966 and 1967. I read Frantz Fanon. I read Emile Césaire. I read Kwame Nkrumah. I read
now you've read Long Walk to Freedom as well.
I've read Long Walk to Freedom. In fact, I did the book on tapes of Long Walk to Freedom.
That's right. Uh-huh.
I just read everybody. Leopold Senghor, and that was a very extraordinary moment for me when I was 20 years old. But none of this would have suggested that I would become an actor, an artist. It's almost divine intervention that I became an actor.